Our scripture readings this morning, the first one comes from the sixth chapter of the book of Deuteronomy, verses 4 and 5. Hear, O Israel, the Lord is our God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your might. Our second reading comes to us from the book of Colossians, chapter 1, verses 15 and 16. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For by him all things were created, both in the heavens and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities. All things have been created through him and for him. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thanks be to God. So we're taking concepts that are maybe boring and reimagining them from the perspective of fun. So last week we did the Trinity, Father, Son, Holy Spirit. What does that mean? How do you really put that in language, and how do you explain it in your own words? And this week we look at the nature of Jesus, and we're calling it the Big Kahuna. Anybody have heard that phrase before, the Big Kahuna? There may be some other words you've heard. Here's another way of saying it, the head honcho, El Jefe. Now, I thought honcho was Spanish, but it's actually used in Spanish, but it actually comes from Japanese. All of them mean the boss, the main person, the big deal. We go a little bit further to say, what are we actually talking about today in the boring words? Jesus is the head of the church. Would you read that with me? Jesus is the head of the church. Is it Lord over? Is it the Big Kahuna? Is it boss? And is that the main issue, or is the nature of Jesus something that's important for us to delve into, or is all of it important? Where do you go with complicated stuff about your beliefs? Because in a survey of people in the United States, when asked to explain what they believe, it's interesting that people just basically pull a lot of things from a lot of sources, and they say, hey, this is what I believe. And it's not necessarily Christian. It's just everything that kind of works. So how do we, as people who come to church, who identify as Jesus followers, how do we convey what we believe to be true? What were we doing with our children this week in VBS? Why was I willing and actually enjoying making a fool of myself with kids this week? We want them to know something about the person of Jesus. Today's doctrine is going to explore the nature of God in Christ, who is fully human, fully divine. Can you say what's in the yellow there? Fully human, fully divine. Sometimes you might see somebody genuflect. Roman Catholics do this, Episcopalians do this, some other traditions will make the sign of the cross. Well, if you explore that in some traditions, what they're doing is they're making two doctrinal statements: Father, Son, Holy Spirit, three in one. Jesus Christ, fully human, fully divine, in the womb of a woman. And so they're making a little statement, not even knowing it when they do that, much like we do. We come to church and we say things, not really realizing what we're doing. How do we re-embrace these things with passion and clarity so that when we go out into the world, we have something to say that's at least grounded in something that makes sense? Well, one of the things we did with the kids is we taught them a Bible verse, and we did it using sign language. And I just have to say, you need to go out of your way today, if you can. And you see the person on the right there. There's Lindsay, who's been our interim children's director. Her term is coming to an end. She's going to stay on as part of our children's moms co-op. But the person on the right there is Madison, and she's going away to college. We are losing an invaluable gift. She's with the children right now. She has gone above and beyond for someone who was really an intern, and we have been blessed to have her. She led us in a little Bible memory verse from Ephesians that captures some of the same things. If I read you the Bible verse, it's much like what we read in Colossians today. What is it that we're really saying? But literally, it's in reading this from Ephesians, then you will be able to understand my insight into the mystery of Christ. Give myself a round of applause. I did it. Thank you. I was paying attention all week. But if you listen to the words, it's something profound. If you read and examine God's word, you will be able to, by reading it and studying it, be able to understand mysteries that go beyond language. That was our starting point last week. Our language is going to fail. It just is. If you ask somebody to write a theological paper, technically what they believe, and somebody was an atheist or really hostile to what you're saying, they would be able to pick it apart. We know that. How do we land on things that we know glorify God, that the rest of the world knows? Well, that's different. That's what we wanted the kids to get this week. Being and living in a different way, telling their story, growing in Christ. It's a journey. So let's pray. Let's delve into this from the scripture, and let's come back with some landing points for all of us. Amen? Can I get an amen? Amen. Holy Spirit, come and illuminate the text that we heard today from Deuteronomy and Colossians, that we would be a place that embraces all of life's emotions, the serious, the contemplative, the sad, with joy and exuberance and love, in a way that shows people we are human beings like everyone else, but we have found somebody who makes everything different. May we be a place of people from all political parties, all experiences, all forms and walks and beliefs come into this place and know they are welcomed and they are specifically invited to know you first. In dependence upon Holy Spirit for understanding, we pray. And all of God's people said, amen. This Bible verse from Deuteronomy is one I memorized as a child. It's one of my life verses. This is what Jesus has quoted. And for the last week and this week and next week, this will be our Old Testament focal point. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with everything. That's the summary. And when asked what's the most important thing, Jesus quotes this. Understanding that Jesus is rooted in Jewish traditions, we should remember how seriously Jewish people take this passage and this notion of following God. Here's some images of Orthodox Jews. And you see the gentleman on the right. He's actually in his required military paraphernalia, his uniform. But you see on his head, he's got a phylactery. And that has scriptures inside of it. And it comes from that Bible verse, which immediately preceding after it says, wear these things on your head and bind them on your arms. And you see somebody who's got the wrappings on the arm in a more close-up picture. Jewish people take this seriously, and it candidly, just without condemning any of us, myself included, none of us get it. None of us really understand what it's like to identify as a Christian where it permeates everything of every waking day. Now, we talk about it. I talk about it. It's what I want for my children. It's what I want for my life. But candidly, I can escape my identity. I can walk around in the world and nobody knows who I believe in or what I believe. I can do that. For Jewish people who are Orthodox, they cannot. They are identified by how they look when they walk around. This is core to their beliefs, and Jesus is repeating it. And in the New Testament, we get a new way of being that isn't about the clothing, it's about the condition and something we strive for. Let's look at the New Testament passage, and another one of these. And what I want you to notice is this is the NIV version, New International Version. And notice there's going to be a little tweak in line one between the NIV, New International Version, and the one we read today, the NASB. And they sound similar. And this is where we all have to admit we get in trouble. I perceive, I've been doing this for about 25 years now, that there are a lot of people like me. I want to be faithful. I grew up in the church. I've been around enough Christians to know there's something that I want. But the struggle to take the time to read and really digest this mystery of God in Jesus is sometimes not something we do. I want somebody to sometimes just tell me the answer and tell me what to do. It's often what I do when I call my dad, who is a pastor. I vent, or I talk about something or have a concern, and then I wait. So what do I do? And you know, and so he won't sometimes say, okay, so what do you think I should do? And he'll often say, I don't know. Well, what good are you? You know, I'm looking for some direction, an answer, and he's telling me what we all know. Sometimes we don't know what to do, but maybe there's a way of being that's rooted in this person. And if we take our time to reflect on it, it's not the answer we get, it's the person we become. For example, the Son is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn. You see, I've highlighted key words. This is what most of us get. What is this New Testament author trying to convey to the early church? Jesus is not like any other human being. He's a human being, but not like any other. Now notice from this passage to the next what changes in the NASB. And this is the version I use. Instead of over all creation, Lord over, in this version, Jesus is the same of all creation. This nuance in the original language to English changes some of it. This is where we get into trouble. Because on Sunday morning, we don't want theology. We want actionable behaviors that we can embrace and understand. Can I get an amen? At least that's what I don't want to go someplace and hear somebody talk and go, well, that was confusing. Well, is In-N-Out open today? I want someone who, but this is the struggle to recognize. Knowing God is a journey of discovery, and it takes time to get all these nuances and to keep learning and to not stop learning to get this big premise. Jesus is Lord of all. He is unlike any other, and he's the one we follow, and there's more to discover every day. Here's a picture here, and this is yesterday's bike ride. That's me summarizing what happened. It was 105. And there's a breakfast burrito on the right. Now, we didn't do this for you, but for the kids, since we're talking about VBS, taking the mystery of Christ so that they will understand the mystery of Christ, the complicated, again, we're all confused sometimes about who God is and how God works in the world. Imagine being a child. What I want to ask you to consider today about the Big Kahuna is your response to who he is matters. See, yesterday, we went bike riding with some of our youth, and we're growing our youth program. Our children's program has kind of gotten caught up to speed. It's going to grow. Our youth program, we've got a new youth director. He's been working with the children, and he's been sort of gathering them and just getting to know them. It takes time. It's harder to build a youth group than it is a children's ministry. But we went bike riding yesterday, and all during the week, we were having fun and laughing, and some of the kids that are there with us, I wanted them to have a good time. We've got some new kids coming. They came on the bike ride. It's really hot. And let's be honest, I'm miserable, okay? I'm in my 50s. I don't want to be out there. But I'm bike riding and biking. I decide I'm going to be funny, which is, again, usually when an alarm bell should go off in my mind. I see them, and I think, I'm going to pass them, and I'm going to say, off-roading. Now, we're using these electronic e-bikes, and the tires don't have any tread. And I go into the grass, and I mean, as soon as the front tire hits the grass, and I'm going fast, it slides out, and I eat it. And I see these kids who I want to come to youth group look back with a horror in their eyes going, he's dying! I'm on the ground. So that was a recreation of the photo. I've got a big scrape on my leg. It's not that we get it right every time. It's that we keep trying. We keep trying to make things engaging and fun and interesting and dynamic for the next generation. It's important. We read a little further. Look, by him all things were created. What is this author conveying? All things have been created through him and for him. What is the author trying to say? There is no other like Jesus. The world has never known a man like this. The world will never know a man like this. What does it mean when the church tries to summarize it and teach a little child Jesus is fully human and fully divine? Try explaining that to a child. It's hard. The mind of God was in Jesus. He was human. He probably made mistakes, but he never made mistakes that were against the will of God. How do you have those conversations? How do you embrace that? I come back to this. Still, here's a picture. Make it fun. Make it fun. That's this series. Make it fun. Laughter is the precursor to faith, I said last week. Reinhold Niebuhr, one of the dry German theologians, wrote, laughter is where people open themselves up to something divine. Can church be a place that is serious, but that is also fun? Can it be? Can I get an amen if it is? I thought about today coming in barefoot, but I just thought there would be enough people who lost their minds. But doesn't that say something? A little bit? That we have to think sometimes about having fun in church when our intention is to make this a place for all ages to enjoy it? I mean, what kind of place are we growing where people can't be free to have fun and laugh and enjoy life in the moments that are serious and meaningful? Baptism, in the midst of that, can we not also make space? Last week, I got back from vacation. This is a picture of someone I grew up with. I grew up with this guy, Kelly Slater, who's the best world server. Here in Texas, people don't know who this is, but he's the greatest living surfer in the history of the sport. I was a little kid when I knew him, and I'm in that book. And 2 weeks ago, I'm bragging, but there's a point. Two weeks, I was in Cocoa Beach, Florida. I was within a mile and a half to 2 miles from where I professed faith in Christ as a young person. I was in the ocean, I was surfing, and it's a huge part of my identity, surfing. I was in the ocean, I professed faith in Christ, I did what I want our kids to do, get to an age where they can say it and mean it. And what I said was, I'll be a Christian no matter what. And I remember it again 2 weeks ago because I'm in the water and I'm out there and I was getting emotional because I can't surf anymore. And it was painful. Bad. I'm on a little brand new surfboard that I bought in California and brought with me. I've only ridden it a few months. I brought it here. And I'm out surfing and I'm trying to catch waves, and I got sick last year. I've gotten a little older. My feet aren't quite as quick, and I could not stand up to the point where I was out there for probably 2 hours. And I came in, and Carrie had been watching me, and she was like, you know, did you catch any waves? And I didn't say a word, but when I got home, I remember feeling loss. And it took me that day and the next day before I went back to the beach and remembered the words I'd said. If I can't do all the things that bring me joy, I'll still be a Jesus follower. If you take away my ability to walk or to function the way I want to, I'll still be a Jesus follower. This is what the New Testament writers want for us. And there's something to think about here. The word kahuna for people like us means boss, but it also means for Hawaiians, wave. And so my question to you is, will you keep learning and understanding nuances? What wave will you ride spiritually? Is it going to be one of joy and freedom and fun, where maybe sometimes we do things in worship that you don't like? That's not funny to you, it's not fun, but you get the intention. We're trying to make space for God to bring people who feel comfortable being a human being where they can meet the human being who was like any, unlike any other. We've got to make space, and we've got to be passionate. And even when our theology is wrong, do we agree that the wave we are riding is the ones created by God? It's important. I want to pray for you. And I want to invite you to consider something when we close today. I've got my skateboard here. I can't surf anymore. I really can't. And no one here gets it because it's not your identity. But when you lose something, maybe some of you have gotten to the point where you don't drive anymore. You've lost something, and you know that moment, but I can still skateboard. There's going to be a day when I can't skateboard, but I can still tell corny jokes. There's going to be a day when I can't bike ride, I can't skateboard, I can't surf, and maybe I can't play the guitar, but I can be a joyous source of the one who changes everything, the real big kahuna, who teaches us and guides us. That's what we wanted this week in VBS. At the end of the service today, you'll see me skateboarding around. Be offended. Be offended. We're going to have some fun. Holy Spirit, come and teach us what we believe to be true in new ways and help us to experience the joy of living that comes only from you. We pray for this in the name of Jesus. And all of God's people said, amen. In the interest of time...